This is going to go coast to coast in 93 minutes, 16.8 seconds. So you probably don't want to try to get on I-24 and keep up with it, because it's going to be moving about Mach 2. An F-16 or an F-18 cannot fly fast enough to stay with this eclipse. You need an SR-71 Blackbird, for those of you that know what that is, in order to fly coast to coast in that time and stay with this in that shadow of the moon. So I brought a homemade, which this one's a little nicer than some others probably, but I spent a lot of whopping dollars on this. I ordered on Amazon for $11, and by ordering it on Amazon for $11 instead of buying it at Staples, I got a twofer, because they shipped the shipping container in another shipping container. Oh yeah, Amazon's great. So the box that came in was even longer, which means it makes a slightly larger projection. It's square and it's not as durable, but so I wanted the round one, and I taped this one up to make it waterproof. You don't need to do any of that. I got my nice NASA sticker on mine to say it's NASA approved. But I made it in my house. So the longer is better, but too long is not. There's some practicality. You probably don't want one of these 20 feet long trying out the wind that will blow you away. So somewhere in this 4 foot range is, or 4 to 5, maybe 3 mm, this produces about a 2/3 inch sun, about 2/3 inch disc inside of it. And the way you use this, you hold the microphone so that I can show them how to use this. So it's got a hole in one end. Okay, so it's nice. I use this nice tape, this nice duct tape, not the great stuff, the more aluminum style tape. So it makes a nice hole that way. And so I left the plastic lid that came with on there, put a cutout in, and then taped over it to sort of punch a real nice hole. So that's the one end, that's your pinhole. The other end, you just need to carve out some kind of a hole to be able to view it. You can do something bigger than this so that more people can see it. But the way you use it is, let's say the sun's back there. So I know the sun's back there, so I put this over my shoulder and I look at the ground in front of me and I move it around until the shadow is perfectly round off this tube, not oval, because I don't have it. So I make it perfectly round and I just slide it up. And there's the sun. And what I'm going to see during a partial, thank you, is this. Now, this isn't for totality. This is for before and after totality. I'm going to see that little baby bump come across the sun. And it's very safe. I'm looking in the opposite direction. And so that's why he's talking about that in that video. This is the safest way to go. It's not very satisfying when you use a shoebox. A shoebox is going to create a disc smaller than this, the dot on the eye. So you probably want to use something longer. Okay. Let's talk about one more thing while I'm on this, because I've had a number of questions. I know it's going to come up. So now's a good time to tackle this one. Cell phones. People go, okay, so my cell phone is a solar viewer. I just point it up there at the sun and just leave there and just kind of look at it all day long. There's going to be a lot of people's phones are going to have damaged cameras on August 22nd of this year. It's a tiny magnifier, doesn't focus on a lot of light, but if you hold it there all day long and use it as a viewer, it's a whole lot different than just going snap and taking a picture. And especially, do not buy one of these aftermarket little lens telescopes that makes it even bigger, because you're going to see smoke rolling out of your phone almost immediately if you try one of those before and after totality. During totality, the sun is only as bright as the full moon. By all means, take this off. And, don't focus on it, but you can do that and still watch the solar eclipse yourself, and just kind of, because these are a pretty wide angle. And you can definitely use it during totality, OK? okay? But not before and after, other than to take a quick shot and bring it back down. If you're gonna hold it there, you're probably gonna have some issues with your phone long term. So some won't, it just depends on that lens that's in front of that chip. Back to safe solar observing. So the big, never look the sun with your eyes, even with sunglasses. And especially don't try to stack sunglasses like this lady's doing up here. That doesn't work either. So flip glasses are good, sunglasses are bad. Never look the sun through any device that isn't made specifically for solar observation with human eyes. There are solar filters out there that they'll have a sticker on that say photo only, not visual use, photographic only. They're not safe. It has to say for visual use with human eyes. There are solar filters ready for photography. Beware of those. Some of those don't filter out UV and IR light that our eyes need, in addition to not filtering as much light. You're never going to get another set of eyes. So far, Ming Wang or anybody else hasn't found us a way to get a new set of eyes, and in most cases, they're not reparable. So painless, instantaneous, and permanent. It's not always instantaneous, but it is painless and permanent. There are times when macular—he talked about in the video—macular degeneration that occurs over years. Landscapers, roofers, people that don't use correct sunglasses with a good UV and IR coating on are susceptible to macular degeneration over time. You just don't want a huge dose on August 21st, while aiding that shortening that amount of time. So this is another. This might be one of the reasons I'm here today. Because everybody says, well, I'm just going to leave my glasses on. And I thought, no. I'm just going to leave these on and act like a blind person. Because the only thing you can see through these is the sun. And the sun is 4,000 times brighter when it's 99% blocked by the moon than it is when it, during totality, when it's 100% blocked by the moon. Except for the corona. There's 4,000 times difference just going from 99% to totality. Totality is very, very safe. Totality is no brighter than the full moon. No one's ever gone blind by looking at the full moon. So during totality, you take them off. So beforehand, partial eclipse, you use your glasses or a filter. During totality, no filter. As soon as these, so I watch an eclipse, and as soon as these go black, take them down. Like, okay, they went black, now I can see totality. This is the other part that's harder, is as soon as I see any brightness, if you're not using a timer, we'll talk about that as well. There are some ways to do timers. Even the timers are going to be off though. So as soon as you see any brightening at all, you just need to look down, put your glasses back on immediately. And because the first thing that's going to happen is it's called a diamond ring effect, where the sun's going to poke through between a valley between two of the mountains on the edge of the moon. That's what you're going to see. It's going to be somewhat dim for just enough time to get you to look down and away. You just need to make sure to do that. And then put your glasses back on and go back to looking at the partial eclipse again afterwards. You have to take those glasses off. I mean, I was out at some people at Arizona State University recently at a NASA camp, and they said, NASA was there, said, look at our new eclipse site. They said, you must always use glasses when looking at the sun. And I raised my hand, I said, that's 100% incorrect. No one that was there at that forum that lived in the path of totality, it was a Mars camp, it wasn't a solar eclipse camp. So I'm going to show you our new NASA site about the solar eclipse. I said, well, that's wrong. And we had a good heated discussion about that. And they actually changed their website. And their website now looks just like this that I have on the bottom of the slide of telling people when to not use their glasses. So where do I get these glasses? Well, now it's getting a little late. You get a really order quickly. Amazon.com, by the way, still is a place that you can get stuff pretty quickly. If you're not a Prime, you might want to pay for 1 or 2 day shipping. If you're not a Prime member, you can get stuff just to make sure you're going to have it in time. These are great places to get them. The EclipseBlast.com, by the way, is a Tennessee company. It's over in Bartlett, Tennessee. They've been turning these out. You just can't believe this. These three companies have been turning these out left and right as fast as they can produce them. And they're, like I said, they're mostly down in Austin. The Science Center's out of, I think, Dyer Observatory may have run out of them last night. This library, almost all the libraries are out of them. So there's very few of them around. You gotta pay them whatever price. It's probably better than waiting the day up and paying $10 a piece or whatever somebody's gonna account you for them. Okay, so obviously, this is not a good thing. Like today, these are not good things that day. This is also, if you're picking a site, it's a Monday. And so I've seen a lot of people, I went out this weekend and I picked out a great site. I said, was it near a factory? I go, well, why is that important? Is there any smokestacks around? I don't know. I said, you might want to look at that because you might end up being blocked by a bunch of smoke. Even one cloud, you're down here on the edge where we have just a few seconds of totality. Even the one time cloud. This week, partly cloudy, go out time class and how long it takes to move. You know, kind of lined up with a tree or something, and use your phone and click start. 60 to 90 seconds. You can miss one cloud to take out your whole day on the total solar eclipse. So that's why I'd say, again, get near the 2 minute line. Get up there where that one cloud, you've got significantly higher chances of seeing it. If you end up under clouds, what's that mean? Well, you're not going to see this for sure. But you're still going to see, you're still going to experience that temperature drop. You're still going to see at least enough of decrease in time of sunset and sunrise to know that, wow, that was different. That's something I've never seen before. There's some things you're still going to get to see in this class and experience. It'll still kind of be kind of like nighttime. Again, that's near further north. And here's all the parks. So some good, I've got 3 stars in front of the parks that are really good, 2 stars in front of the parks that are not quite as good. Anything over 2 minutes, I gave 2 stars to. But all of these are pretty good. Rather like 1 minute and 15 seconds, it's a whole lot better than here. So, why Gallatin? Okay, so here's the timing for Gallatin that I did. And this is something that is, when you look at times, you need to look for this word right here, lunar limb corrected. Near the center line, it doesn't make that much of a difference. Out here, it makes an extreme difference. Because, and I told some of my friends who are here today to get this one app for $1.99 called Solar Eclipse Timer. I only owned it myself for a couple days when I gave that advice, and then I went and checked it and found out it's not literally corrected. So I told them wrong. I told Joyce, I told you, and Steve, I told you gave you all the wrong data. That's another reason I know there's a whole bunch of people that are going out speaking and showing maps and the internet sites and websites, they're wrong. They're showing either fine as you're further in the band, upwards in that, in the middle of the 7 miles, when you're on the edge like we are, they're wrong. They're very wrong. So they'll tell you, like my over on Twin Springs, it tells me in the middle of my call sack, it actually says I got 25 seconds. I got like 6 seconds there. It tells me that, it would tell me that the south end of Twin Springs subdivision is in the path of totality. You're not in the path of totality safely until you get north 5 houses in that subdivision. There's a whole bunch of websites and things. We're in the middle school. I did a presentation here to teach them. We're just going to walk outside because we're in the path of totality. I said, no, you're not. You're not going to see it. You're going to see is that. You're going to see 99.9%, but you're not. All your students are going to miss this. They're all going to miss this. Yes? If you're this far out, if you walk every 100 yards, you're going to gain about a second. You're this far out.
Oh, $35,000 would be good.
That's all the way to the center, yes. Anything Nashville and north is going to be really good. Some people go to Centennial Park, it's not my favorite place, but I understand it's very historical. There's a lot of trees there, and I'm afraid people won't get to see that F5 tornado coming out from Centennial Park. But I think this is going to be pretty significant. Here's Lebanon, Tennessee, which I've been recommending to a lot of people, because 840 is going to be a whole lot easier to travel than 65. And so if you want to get north of, in Lebanon, maybe north of Highway 70 there, out near that TRW factory, this is a great place to go.